The video was created for educational and entertainment purposes only. Sulfur trioxide is highly dangerous. A lot of dangerous concentrated sulfuric acid vapors are released during this procedure. Really, do not mess around with sulfur trioxide. Welcome back everyone, today we are going to make some sulfur trioxide. For this, 150 grams of phosphorus pentoxide, which represents a huge excess, 140 milliliters of 69% sulfuric acid, which contain 2.5 moles of pure sulfuric acid and 0.3 grams of boric acid or another polymerization inhibitor are needed. Obviously, sulfur trioxide is really dangerous. A lab coat will be worn throughout the preparation. At the beginning, we will wear safety goggles because no sulfur trioxide fumes are generated. And when the sulfur trioxide starts being generated, we are going to put on a gas mask. As you are going to see later on in the video, sulfur trioxide readily evaporates, forming concentrated sulfuric acid vapor. Therefore, we had a full body chemically resistant protecting suit available if the fuming got out of hand. Two pairs of nitrile gloves were worn throughout the procedure. Sulfur trioxide having a narrow liquid range between 16.9 and 45 degrees Celsius is pretty hard to store. It can either be stored in a PTFE lidded bottle or in ampules. Ampules are the safest way of storing sulfur trioxide. Therefore, a big ampule was made from a 100 ml round bottom flask. The flask was heated over an oxyacetylene torch and the neck was stretched out. This way we will have an easier time sealing the ampule later on. In total, two of these ampules were produced. As I don't want to transfer any liquid sulfur trioxide for obvious safety concerns, we are going to use this adapter, connect it to the flask, and for sealing it we will use PTFE tape. This will simply be wrapped around the ground glass joint of this adapter. Pouring liquid sulfur trioxide from one flask to another would release a ton of sulfur trioxide vapors, which will react to form concentrated sulfuric acid. Because we wanted to be able to determine the yield later on, the flasks were weighed and labeled in advance. The neck belonging to the flask was also labeled. 150 grams of phosphorus pentoxide were weighed out in advance. They were weighed out directly in this round bottom flask. Then we started with apparatus assembly. I have never tried the synthesis before, and for this reason, 50 milliliters of the 150 milliliters in total of 96% sulfuric acid were measured out and directly transferred to the phosphorus pentoxide flask. Every time phosphorus pentoxide is exposed to the open air, you should do whatever you want to do quickly, because phosphorus pentoxide will suck up moisture. But while adding the sulfuric acid, this wasn't the case because we had to add the sulfuric acid slowly. I didn't know what would happen and how exothermic this reaction would be. The reaction wasn't at all violent, but still, sulfur trioxide vapors directly became visible. The distillation apparatus was assembled as quickly as possible. At the side of the receiving flask, a gas trap was set up. The gas trap was filled up with concentrated sulfuric acid. Water cannot be used. Sulfur trioxide would react too violently with water, and the sulfuric acid also prevents moist air from entering. To the top of the distillation bridge, some boric acid as polymerization inhibitor was added. You have probably wondered why we have this electric thermocouple here. Well, it's attached to our cooling water. The cooling water should be kept between 23 and 30 degrees Celsius throughout the entire procedure. All the joints were lubricated with sulfuric acid in advance, and here you can see me adding some more concentrated sulfuric acid to the phosphorus pentoxide. Due to the narrow liquid range of sulfur trioxide, the cooling water should be kept between 23 and 30 degrees Celsius throughout the entire procedure. You want the sulfur trioxide to condense, but you don't want it to solidify in the condenser. This is what the mixture of phosphorus pentoxide and now 100 milliliters of sulfuric acid looked like. to properly start off the dehydration reaction, the heating mantle was turned on low heat. Occasionally, a small amount of boiling water was added to the cooling water tank in order to heat it up. Phosphorus pentoxide is a powerful dehydrating agent. Phosphorus pentoxide will react with water to form tetrametaphosphoric acid first. This will later on react with even more water to form polyphosphoric acid, which reacts with more water to form phosphoric acid. After only a short while, these interesting looking needles of sulfur trioxide appeared in the receiving flask. The reaction of phosphorus pentoxide with sulfuric acid looks something like this. Phosphorus pentoxide and sulfuric acid form sulfur trioxide and phosphoric acid. Because our sulfuric acid contained some water, a large excess of phosphorus pentoxide was used. You can touch the distillation apparatus without burning yourself. Sulfur trioxide has a really low boiling point. Because of the temperature of around 26 degrees Celsius of our cooling water, we collected liquid sulfur trioxide at first, which solidified once in the flask. If the sulfur trioxide solidifies in the wrong places, like the neck of this ampule, a heat gun can be used to gently melt the sulfur trioxide. To add the final milliliters of sulfuric acid, the heating mantle was turned off somewhere in the middle of the procedure, and the rest of the sulfuric acid was added via an addition funnel. Without the use of an addition funnel, a lot more sulfur trioxide vapors would leave the apparatus, as you can see here. Dense white fog of concentrated sulfuric acid and sulfur trioxide. Later on, during the procedure, the contents of the reaction flask actually turned to complete liquid. The temperature of the heating mantle was raised to medium heat. In the distillation bridge, there was also a small amount of solid sulfur trioxide. Furthermore, it looked like the boric acid we added dissolved in the sulfur trioxide being carried over into the receiving flask. At some point, there was a lot of smoke in our gas trap. But you have to note that without the gas trap, a lot of vapors, a lot more vapors, would have been released directly into the room. This would not have been a big problem, because we had strong ventilation running in the background, but it's still good to limit the amount of sulfuric acid vapors being produced. When the receiving flask ampule was full enough for my taste, I removed the tape, which was used to hold it in place. To the second ampule that we used, a small amount of boric acid has been added in advance. After melting the sulfur trioxide in the neck of the ampules will be switched out. Using a heat gun, the connection between the ampule and the apparatus was freed of sulfur trioxide. The flask was switched out, and another small amount of boric acid, approximately 0.1 grams, were added to this flask. To keep the sulfur trioxide in the flask and the moisture out of the flask, we covered the opening with aluminium foil. You can have a close look at a mixture of liquid and solid sulfur trioxide. Back outside, again with the oxyacetylene torch, the ampule was sealed shut. The sealing process actually went way easier than I thought, and there was nearly no sulfur trioxide vapor leaving the ampule. The neck was first off stretched out just a little bit to make it thinner. We wanted to make sure that this ampule is really well sealed, and therefore we cooled it down using some ice. The air will be cooled down and it will contract. The ampule can be sealed more efficiently. There will be no bubbles in the glass stemming from expanding air. The ampule was put aside and it was allowed to cool down. And there you go, a nice and perfectly sealed ampule of sulfur trioxide. With the second ampule, we won't be as lucky. After a short while, the same interesting looking sulfur trioxide crystals appeared in the second receiving flask. The heating mantle was occasionally turned off, not to let the reaction get too hot. Using the heat gun, we remelted the contents of the first sulfur trioxide ampule in order to make sure all of the boric acid dissolved. This is important because you don't want any polymerized sulfur trioxide. It wouldn't look as beautiful and it would also be useless. At some point, the sulfur trioxide production ceased. The heating mat was turned off and we tried to collect as much as we can. Hot phosphoric acid can actually etch glass, and therefore we also didn't want to let this reaction go for too long. Again, the sulfur trioxide in the neck of the ampule was melted and the ampule was disconnected. Because no more sulfur trioxide was going over, the whole of the apparatus was plugged with some aluminium foil. Actually, aluminium foil is pretty resistant to sulfur trioxide in the short term. We tried to seal the ampule, but we sadly fucked up. There was a hole blown into the ampule and I tried to fix it using a glass strut and stretching out the glass, but it didn't work. The hole either started to get bigger or new holes started to appear. Obviously, sulfur trioxide cannot be stored this way with a damaged ampule. But before proceeding, I decided to do the cleanup. The sulfur trioxide remaining in the apparatus must first be neutralized with concentrated sulfuric acid, forming oleum. Water cannot be used as water would react extremely violent with sulfur trioxide. It was too much of a hassle to film this part, actually, but we basically dipped the open parts, into some concentrated sulfuric acid, and we also let some concentrated sulfuric acid flow through the distillation bridge. As a side note, if you ever get a piece of glass stuck somewhere, don't try to use brute force. Use a heat gun, or you can also really carefully use a Bunsen burner to heat up the outer part of the part that's stuck. Gently rotate and pull at the piece of glassware that's stuck. At some point, you will be able to see that it can be pulled off really easily. No damaged glass, as it's the case with other brute force strategies, and you get back your piece of glass undamaged. To get back to the damaged ampule, you can see some vapors escaping. It can obviously not be stored like that. For short-term storage, aka a few days, the top was sealed using hot glue. We will have to destroy that sulfur trioxide as quickly as possible, and I appreciate any ideas you have. Put them down into the comments and I'll try to do it. In the end, we were left with this. One ampule containing a lot of solidified sulfur trioxide and one ampule containing just a little. Sulfur trioxide makes really interesting needle-like shapes. The main ampule was weight. By subtracting the weight of the flask and the amount of boric acid added, we come to the conclusion that 69.4 grams of sulfur trioxide were obtained. This is just the main flask and this corresponds to a yield of around 35%. Because I wanted this ampule for decoration and we don't really have a use for dangerous sulfur trioxide, the sulfur trioxide ampule may be embedded in resin soon. In the reaction flask that was used, there was mainly phosphoric acid and also sulfuric acid remaining. This will be turned into harmless sodium sulfate and sodium phosphate by slowly adding sodium carbonate solution. Adding water, say even sodium carbonate, to an acid is always a bad idea, yet I didn't have any other solution. We simply went slow until everything was neutralized and it was occasionally checked with pH strip. The amount of sulfur trioxide contained in the damaged ampule wasn't included in the yield. If you want, you can, as I said, write any ideas you have what we should do with this down into the comments and I'll try if I can do it. But if you like this video, make sure to drop me one of these and consider subscribing to my channel for more interesting chemistry content in the future. I wish all of you a nice day. Until next time. Bye.